Hello everyone. Today we will be covering the learning objective 1 of procurement risk and contract management. So I'm Sanjay and I will be taking you through all the modules, and then we will also have a special lecture on how to do the assignment and what all aspects have to be covered in the assignment. So today we will cover the first learning objective. So in this we have three units, which are to define procurement and contract management. And then we have examined the principles of project management as applied to large multinational organization. And the third unit is to evaluate the importance of sustainable procurement. So we begin with the first one, which is define procurement and contract management. So we will first go through what do these terminologies mean, how these are applicable in the organizations. So the first definition is provided by CIPS, which is procurement is the business management function that ensures identification, sourcing, access and management of external resources that an organization needs or may need to fulfill its strategic objectives. So basically it means that any organization, it has to procure some of its services from external vendor. So the procurement management, it basically relates to how to initiate that relationship and when the procurement function and the maintenance function is going on. So what are the activities that needs to be carried out? What are the contractual agreements? What are the different terms and conditions that need to be put in the contract? So it is basically the end-to-end cycle of entire procurement. So another definition is that of provided by another author, which is procurement as a function of supply chain, which directly delivers overall cost savings, quality movements, and fulfills customer and supplier relationship management. So it basically relates to how procurement is an important component of supply chain, and it contributes towards cost savings, quality improvements, and supplier relationship management. Moving ahead, we look at the different stages in procurement, which are essential for any procurement that an organization is undertaking with the external vendor. So first one is basically demand determination. So what it relates to is what is the need of the organization to seek procurement. Basically, what do they need from external vendor? Can the activity be carried out as an internal function by their own resources? And if not, like, to what extent do they want to go for procurement? Do they want to be dependent fully on the external vendor, or they would want their own to deploy their own team also? Then, so demand, it basically relates to what is the requirement for procurement. Then we have source determination. Basically, you carry out an evaluation and industry analysis of the vendors, and you see which vendor is most suited for you. So for small procurement, you can go in for the vendors which are already associated with you, or you can go in for any vendor in the market. For example, if you are purchasing stationery, you need not do a due diligence, a very thorough due diligence. Basically, it's a very small value item, even though it's a large organization. But when you are engaging a vendor to develop your entire IT system, that requires a thorough due diligence. You want to be sure that the vendor is technically competent to deliver the services, whether the system that they will develop meets the requirements of your organization. So that, those things you need to cover in your vendor research. Then supplier selection. So how are you going to select the supplier? What are the technical evaluation criteria? What are the financial evaluation criteria? I mean, how are you going to select a supplier? Whether it is only a single vendor, whether the job is too complex, or are you going to call in multiple vendors? Are you going to float a tender to select the vendor? So these aspects that need to be determined. Then you have the purchase order processing. So once you have selected the vendor, you will send out the purchase order. So normally in procurement, what happens is that you procure goods in stages. For example, if you're developing an IT system and you want to purchase hardware, so you may purchase the hardware only when you need it. For example, you want to distribute, say, in your organization, you expect the load on the servers to increase across every year. So if you are estimating the load in the fifth year, you will not purchase the server in the first year itself. Slowly you will scale up. So that way your purchase order is prepared so that it meets your demands and the total cost of ownership is less, whereas no resources are lying idle. Then you have other aspects in procurement, which is like order monitoring, the receipt of goods and services, and invoice verification, and then payment processing. So this sums up the entire end-to-end cycle of the procurement. So from the project management perspective, procurement, it basically relates to what are the inputs, what are the tools and techniques, and what are the outputs. So the procurement function is explained from a project management perspective. So in the input section, what you see is like you document your requirements so that you can give a formal document to the supplier or the vendor. So how do you do that? First, you prepare the project management plan. Then you prepare the procurement documents, which will be the tender document, which will be the technical evaluation criteria, which will be the financial evaluation criteria, the scope of work, the service level agreements, the eligibility criteria. So those things will go into inputs. Then what are the approved change requests? Like in many IT, I'm giving an example of IT projects, when a company engages an external vendor to develop the IT system. So some of the requirements may not be very clear at the beginning, but they may become necessary after the vendor is onboarded. But since these requirements are not documented in the agreement, there is a scope for change request. So the change request is agreed by both the parties, and then the vendor is paid based on the extra work that he has done. So the approving the change request is up to the organization. Then work performance reports, which is basically how do you monitor the performance of the vendor. So that is important, and then work performance data. So for example, what is a monthly progress report? For example, if you are an e-commerce organization, you would like to see the transactions, you would like to see how many transactions failed, you would like to see the volume of sales that you are generating. So these are project management approvals to procurement. Then in tools and technique, you have contract change control system, the procurement performance reviews, which is basically how well your system is performing, and inspection and audits, whether your system, are there any hacking attempts in your system, whether your system has full information security protocols, and then performance reporting, whether the payment system is working properly, are there transactions which are falling through, and the claims administration. So these aspects are used as tools and techniques in procurement. Then the output are basically the work performance information and the change request, which is basically what the vendor submits you as the report. And then the project document updates, which you as the in-house team would be monitoring. So this is how you undertake a project management approach to procurement. So next we move on to the CRELEC metrics. So this metric, it basically explains like how your relationship with the supplier to be. So the metric is divided into four main quadrants. So based on the on the x-axis, you have the supply risk, which means it goes from low to high, and then on the y-axis, you have the profit impact. So on the lower, on the extreme left and the down quadrant, you have the non-critical items, which means the supply risk is low and the profit impact is low. So for selecting vendor for these items, you can do a product standardization or process efficiency, which means that there are many suppliers available in the market. For example, you want to purchase notepads for your for your company. So you can go and get to any vendor. So but what you can do is you can create a process efficiency. Like suppose your organization, you need like say 100 notepads every month. So the moment your stock falls below 1995, then you automatically initiate your processing. So you can automate this process. You need not go and interact with the vendor every time. You may shortlist the vendor and then you can immediately send the order and the vendor will deliver. So this is a non-critical item. Then in the y-axis, if you go by profit impact type, then you have leverage items, which means that where the supply risk is low, which means that what you can do is you can use your position as a dominant buyer to explore, to like negotiate with the supplier. Say for example, a company like Pepsi, they make snacks. So what they do, they go to the farmers and then they try to negotiate continuous supply. They try to negotiate rates because they are a dominant buyer. So that way, they exploit their full purchasing power. And then you target the pricing strategies or negotiations. So again, what happens is that in this type of negotiation, you target the a rate with in which both the parties benefit, which means the farmer, for the farmers also it is sustainable, and for the Pepsi also it is, the rates are good enough. Then we move into the strategic items, which are like the profit impact is high and then the supply risk is also high. So in this quadrant, what you do is you develop a strategic relationship with the supplier. For example, an automobile company, say BMW, they want to develop say leather for the seats. So for the supplier, they would want to enter into a strategic relationship so that there is a long-term relationship and the supplier is associated with the company, and there is like collaboration and innovation. Then you have the bottleneck items, where the supply risk is high but profit impact is low. So what happens here is that there is low control of suppliers, and it is production based scarcity. For example, you can say like gold mining. So the suppliers have low control. Basically, where they will find reserve, only there they can like get the gold, and it is very limited. Similarly for oil companies. And there is production-based scarcity. So there is only limited amount that they can produce. So that creates a bottleneck item. But for this, it again goes by the demand-supply thing. So basically what you need to remember about this matrix is that you need to classify your vendor in among the four quadrants. Like what is the most suitable quadrant that your vendor will fit in, and then you need to take appropriate steps. So we've given an example of procurement in NHS. So how it happens. So here they have like the master data, how they purchase to pay, how they maintain the catalogs, then how do they capture the document requirements, then NHS also has a criteria of like providing opportunities to small and medium scale businesses where they can create a scope of innovation. It's not like only the big companies can participate. So there is a document on the internet also, you can go and see like how NHS procures different items for the entire healthcare ecosystem. So another example we look into is the EU procurement cycle. So this is very important, while like for most of the tenders, whether it is Department of Transportation, whether it is Department of Defense, whether it is Department of Healthcare. So this is the protocol that they follow. So first of all, they identify the need for the procurement, which means that it is based on the EU, European Union directives and thresholds. Then they release the pre-information notice, and so which gives out a broad scope of work and the requirements of the different departments. Then what they do is they develop a compliance strategy, which is basically the contract strategy, the tender evaluation criteria. Like the tender evaluation criteria may comprise of, for example, the financial criteria and a number of years they have been in business, what are the contracts they have executed in the past. So those are the criteria, some of the criteria that is included in the RFP document. Then a market survey and industry workshop is carried out to see how many vendors are interested in the project, whether the tender has too many restricting criteria, what criteria should be removed or it can be softened. So that way the entire process it follows, and the compilation of tender documents, then you invite the tenders, then the tender evaluation, then the signing of the contract, and then the post contract signing, the work is monitored. So that is the entire cycle of EU procurement cycle. So another example we see, like how procurement at Boeing is carried out. So here if you see the different parts of the Boeing planes, they come from different countries. For example, the cargo access doors comes from Sweden, the mid forward fuselage, it comes from Japan, the wing tips, it comes from Korea, and the horizontal stabilizer, it comes from Italy, the passenger entry doors, it comes from France, again fixed and movable landing edge, it comes from US. So procurement is a very complex function in organizations such as Boeing and Airbus. So they need to have a very well defined roles, very well defined functionalities for procurement. So it is actually as important as the core business itself. So next we look into what is contract management. So contract management is basically is a process which ensures all party to the contract, they meet their obligations in order to satisfy the operational objectives of the contract. So in simple terms, it's a contract management, it refers to the entire activity that that is carried out so that both the parties meet their commitments to the contract or agreement. So another definition we have by Schumann and Icon, that the purpose of contract management is to ensure the rights and duties of each party to contracts are provided, to ensure delivery on time, right quality, and or within budget. So it basically relates to what are the expectations which those are documented in the contract, and then meeting those expectations. So why contract management? Why do you need to study contract management separately? So there is always a chance that the vendor may not be able to fulfill all the criteria that are listed in the contract or agreement. So it can be due to certain events. So there's always a risk. So it is a chance of an event occurring that would cause actual project circumstances to differ from those assumed when forecasting project benefits and costs. So which means that due to change in business environment or any other reason, the project circumstances may change. So how do you handle that? So that is how you you can understand using contract management. So effective contract management, it basically incorporates identifying, monitoring and managing all risks and opportunities over the life cycle of the project contract to achieve project objectives. So it basically relates to understanding the risks and leaving a scope for making changes based on mutual agreement. So that is one very important aspect of contract management. Then also the risks cannot be correctly identified unless there are clear project objectives. So you need to first identify the objectives, the roles and responsibilities, the scope of work, the timelines, the payment schedules. So once these are identified, there can be some scope of negotiation with respect to the contracts. So earlier we discussed procurement life cycle. Now the contract management life cycle also, you see there are different 10 stages. So so these stages relate to the request, generate, negotiate, approval of contract, execution of contract, capturing the contract, compliance, report and audit, review and amend, and renewal. So all of these, it starts from when you want to enter into an agreement. So you request the draft contract so that you can include the scope, and then both the parties can review and then they can agree and then sign it. Then you have to generate the contract documentation, and if required, you can negotiate at the agreement stage. Like if the scope of work has changed from the tender document, then you may ask the bidder to revise the financials. So these things are all included in the contract management life cycle. So what are the key criteria of successful contract management? So basically, how can you monitor that contract is successful? So first thing is that arrangement for service delivery continue to be satisfactory for both parties. So if both the parties are satisfied with the work, that means your contract is effective. Then expected business benefits and value for money are being achieved. So whatever is defined as the objectives of the project, if they are being achieved, that means your contract management is successful. And the provider is cooperative and responsive. Again, a very important criteria for a successful contract management. And others include like the customer understands its obligations. So the legal team of both the parties are involved, and the customer, they understand like what is expected of them as per contract. Then there are no disputes or surprises. Like the vendor does not suddenly get up one day and say, no, I will not work here. Those have to be tightly protected. Then efficiencies are being realized. So these are some of the characteristics or some of the indicators that you can see to assess whether your contract is successful. So next, we'll look into the principles of project management as applied to a large multinational organization. So we have this video in project management. So probably you can see it in your time. The presentation will be circulated to you. So this video, it shows how to manage a project, which is very difficult and which is an innovative project. And it's an infrastructure project, which I think which is being built in Norway. $47 billion coastal highway, and that is being built in Norway. So it's a very end video. So probably when you go through it, you'll understand it more. So next we look into what are different definitions of project management. So project management is a widely studied topic. There are different definitions which have been provided by different entities. So here you see like one of the definition is a temporary management environment, usually undertaken in phases, created for the purpose of delivering one or more business output. Or a simple definition by US PMI, Project Management Book of Knowledge, is a temporary endeavor undertaken to create a unique product, service, or result. So different entities have provided different definitions of project management. So the basic idea is that a project is managed well so that it provides the intended benefits and is delivered within the constraints of time, quality, and resources. So this is one of the basic definitions of project management. So you can go through all these definitions and to have a better understanding on the project management. So I recommend that you this PMBOK guide, it is like the ultimate book for project management, but it is also very much academic. So there is another book called Prince 2 Manual. So that is the UK standard for project management. This PMI, PMBOK guide is US standard for project management. So you can choose like whichever you want to pursue. Both certifications are equally recognized in the industry. And however, PMP certification is slightly more difficult and Prince 2 becomes slightly easier. So otherwise you can choose on the on your area of interest and you can undertake these certifications, and these two books are very useful. So how do we proceed? Because project management is a very, very vast universe of study, and there is too much of academic literature. So you need to understand like which field you want to study project management. So like we already saw that there is no single definition of projects or project management. So the ones we've seen are all different, although you can identify certain common themes, like it relates to all the projects are unique, and then there is outcome, objectives, or the requirements, which are common to all the projects. Then how the project will be undertaken, who will undertake this, the roles and responsibilities, someone has to make this happen. So that is defined in a project. Then the start point and end point, basically what is it that you are going to achieve, what is the business objective, what is your strategic objective, and then time, cost, quality. So these are the constraints. So you have to complete a project within the time, within the budget, and as per the specifications of the requirements provided by the client or the organization. So these are the constraints in the project. So project management is generally undertaken by using different types of project management methodology or models. So here I have mentioned some of the most commonly used models in software development. So waterfall model is one of the most traditional or one of the most oldest model that is being followed for project management. Then you have the iterative model. Then you have the V model and the spiral model. So you can go through all of these. Some of the books are placed in your Moodle folder. So you can go through these and get more understanding on the different models of project management. And of late, in the last decade, agile methodology has become very famous among different organizations. So the advantage of this methodology is that it is very flexible as compared to the traditional project management methodologies. So it allows you to make changes built on real time. The requirements may change, so this model allows you to adapt to the changing requirements. So another key aspect that you need to remember is that there are different components of the different concepts related to project management. So it is again a very wide field. So for example, if you see stakeholder management, so stakeholder management is again, you need to assess the different needs of the stakeholder, then what are the interests of the stakeholder, how much will be the participation in the project. Then you have risk management, which is another wide field. So all of these are, they come under a single category of project management. So As you see, the main phases in the project management are initiate, plan, execute, monitor, and close. So under these categories, you have different management concepts and you have different management plans. So these are these form the key principles of project management. For example, under execute, you see you have configuration management, you have change management, and then management concepts associated are stakeholder communication, like whatever changes you are doing, you are communicating to the stakeholder, and then effective meetings to see how those, how the implementation of the project is going on. So these are some of the key principles of project management. So here you see that I've used a software of MS Project, Microsoft Project, to draw a project plan. So it is a very helpful studio. It is a very helpful software, and we use it in our company like almost on a regular basis. Whenever we have to prepare the project management documents, or when you have to prepare a new business plan, so this is very important, project plan. So next we look into the importance of sustainable procurement. So before I begin, sustainable procurement, it basically relates to how your procurement will not get disrupted due to changes in business environment, and how it is sustainable for both you as well as your supplier. So we'll look at some of the definitions of sustainable procurement. So one of the definitions is procurement that has the most positive environmental, social, and economic impacts possible over the entire life cycle, which means that the procurement which is not detrimental for the environment, which has a social impact, and which has economic impact. Basically, it provides employment to the suppliers, and it is cost effective for the buyers. Then another definition you see is that sustainable procurement involves the sustainability aspects related to goods or services and to the suppliers along the supply chain. So it is basically that you generate value for your suppliers as well. So these are some of the definitions of sustainable procurement. So what are the key considerations that you need to keep in mind while considering sustainable procurement? So what are the stakeholder demands? Like who are the stakeholders in procurement? You have the suppliers, you have the logistics partners, you have the company, you have employees. So what are the demands? So that, what are the customer requirements? For example, if you are building if you are an automobile manufacturer and you are procuring and if you are procuring say I'm sorry, I was getting caught. So if you are automobile manufacturer and you are procuring say tires from another supplier, so what you need to do is you need to understand the customer requirements, whether it is for a sports utility vehicle, whether or it is for a sedan. So what type of tires do you need? Then whether you have the license to operate. Then what are the legislation? What are the procurement standards? Whether there are trade barriers in procuring the goods? Whether there is impact reduction in the environment? Like how are you procuring it? Whether it contributes to business efficiency. For example, you may be a supplier in Japan and you may be a purchaser in Canada. So again, it or you can be a purchaser in say European Union. So again, geographical distribution, it may present a lot of challenges. So that may reduce the business efficiency. So you need to identify who your suppliers are, whether you need to do, whether you can source from those suppliers effectively. And then you have other key components are like brand, the reputation, and what are the employee expectations? Like the employees, they need to be involved in the procurement. So you have, whether you have a separate purchasing department or whether the employees are deployed on a part-time basis for the procurement functions. So these are the key considerations that you need to keep in mind for sustainable procurement. Then next we have the supply chain imperative with respect to sustainable procurement. So this slide, it basically relates to how mature your supply chain is with the, and how effective it is. I mean, whether it is providing a competitive advantage or not. So if your supply chain, if you have a supply chain visibility and you have managed and you have identified the risk and you have developed a strategic relationship with the supplier, so it basically leads to the sustainability in supply chain. So it basically gives you visibility, it gives you predictability, and ultimately it gives you sustainability. So these are the key aspects which you need to keep in mind when you're designing a supply chain. Then again, you have the economic, the ecological, and social, which we, the three aspects which we discussed for sustainable procurement. Then here we look into the main benefits of sustainable procurement. So there are many benefits. You can have reduced cost savings, and then you can create local employment, which can lead to local economic growth. Then you may get positive public relations. For example, if you see the annual report for a company like Unilever, so they do a lot of things on sustainability. So the entire business model has now focused on sustainability, like how they are going to sustain the business by reducing the environmental footprint, by sourcing sustainably. So, and that also gives a positive public relations to Unilever. Then you have the social harm reduction. So it relates to, like, you're not cutting down trees, or you're not causing damage to the environment. So that way, if you have a sustainable procurement in place, that means your social harm reduction, it will not take place. And then you have energy efficiency, environmental benefit, of course. When you're procuring, when you're targeting a sustainable procurement, you have to focus on the environmental factor and energy efficiency. For example, you can use a fleet of electrical vehicles in your logistics department rather than using the conventional fuels. And then you have a high road workplace benefits. So these are some of the key factors benefits that you can derive out of a sustainable procurement practice. So, like I said, I was talking about Unilever, like how it has enabled sustainable procurement in the last decade. So, the core business of the company is through sustainability. So, by 2018, the 56% of the agricultural raw materials were sustainably sourced, which means there was no damage to the environment and reduced risks. And 600 million euros savings were derived. So when all these criteria are met, you can say that the company has achieved the state of sustainable procurement. So the company also has economic benefits, like, for example, the sustainable living brands grew 69% faster than the rest of the business and delivered to 75% of Unilever's growth in 2018. So again, it, here you see the economic goal is met. Then you have the environmental goal with relation to your 56% of agricultural raw material sourcing. So that meets your environmental goal. So these are the, this is Unilever is a classic example of sustainable procurement. So that's all for today. If you have any questions, you can let me know.